So good morning everyone. Now hence forth for maybe 40-50 minutes we will discuss about peripheral vascular diseases. So coming to the pathophysiology, most of the times peripheral vascular disease, the cause, most common cause is atherosclerosis. But sometimes it may occur suddenly because of thrombus from one area going into other area, that is called embolism. But most common is atherosclerosis. So which are the factors that can contribute to the development of peripheral vascular diseases? This can be mainly atherosclerosis, then thrombus formation anywhere in the body, embolism from one area to other area, increased coagulopathy of the blood. So in that situation we need to do coagulation profile for that patient. Then hypertension also can lead to peripheral vascular disease, and inflammatory processes, infections, etc. are rare causes. So peripheral vascular disease can be arterial disease or venous disease. So coming to arterial insufficiency, so whenever there is insufficiency, that is arterial insufficiency, the blood, arterial blood which is going to the target organ will be less, and because of decreased blood flow towards the tissue, it causes ischemia, and that is the reason for pain. On examination, pulse on that limb will be diminished or absent because the blood going there is very less. Patients may have sharp stabbing pain because of ischemia, particularly when they use that limb. म्हणजे कधी आपण जास्त चाललं की थांबायला लागतं, that is called ischemic pain, that is called claudication. And venous insufficiency मध्ये there is decreased return of blood from the tissues, म्हणजे blood, purified blood from the heart goes to the tissues through arteries, and once the oxygen is used in that particular area, that used that impure blood should return to the lungs to get purified again. But in venous insufficiency what happens, the used blood in the limb, the return is not good, and that causes the venous insufficiency. And because of the low return of the impure blood, the pure blood cannot go into that area, and that causes congestion in that area and stasis of blood. But in these cases the arterial pulses will be felt. Since the venous return is not good, the blood stays there for more time, and that causes edema of that limb and pain in that limb. And in later stages it causes skin changes, that brown discoloration of the skin, and venous ulcers. So this is the comparison chart for the arterial and venous disorders. Regarding the skin, in arterial diseases it will be cold or hairless, shiny, pallor on the elevation, and there will be rubor, means it will become red on dangling. But on the venous diseases it will be warm, and there will be some edema and pigmentation. Pain wise, in arterial disease it will be sharp and stabbing pain, while in venous disease it will be aching and cramping pain on activity. But on activity, on arterial, if it is a arterial cause, the pain increases, but if it is a venous cause, the pain decreases. So we need to ask the patient whether it is increasing on activity or decreasing on activity to differentiate arterial and venous. Coming to the ulcers, arterial ulcers will be severely painful, pale, the base will be grey, and found on heel, toes and dorsum of foot. But in venous disease, moderately painful, the base will be pink in the venous ulcers, and these are mainly found on medial aspect of the ankle. Pulse, I had already told, it is often absent in arterial disease and usually present in venous diseases, and edema is frequently common in venous diseases. So So we should know how common is the peripheral vascular disease. It affects about 1 in 20 people over the age of 50 years. It is studied in US. So PVD is only diagnosed in 50% of the population, and we miss the diagnosis in 50% of the people. So symptomatic PVD carries at least 30% risk of death within 5 years and almost 50% within 10 years, primarily because of MI and stroke. So these are the different arteries in the body for which we can do intervention. We till now, most of the people know that we do angioplasty for the heart. But as like heart, we can do angioplasty for carotid arteries, intracranial arteries, the subclavian artery, then aorta, this iliac arteries, femoral arteries, tibial arteries. Wherever there is block, we can go there and open those blocks if it is symptomatic. So it is not only coronaries, it can affect anywhere in the body and we can treat that. So coming to the symptoms, most of the times patients will have leg or hip pain during walking. That is called intermittent claudication. Once they stop walking, the pain goes. So we need to note the claudication distance, because if the claudication distance is less than 200 meter, then that patient needs treatment. If it is more than 200, we can tell them to just do exercise, keep on walking, so that the collateral circulation will develop and that will take care of the oxygen need of that limb. So if the claudication distance is less than 200 meter, that should be referred to us for further evaluation. Patients can have numbness, tingling or weakness in the leg, burning or aching pain in feet or toes when resting. Sore on leg or foot that won't heal, that is a common symptom of PVD. And if it is advanced PVD, it can lead to cold legs or feet. It is critical limb ischemia, in that case the skin color will change and patients will have continuous pain. So these are the 5 P's of peripheral vascular diseases. It is pulselessness, patients may have difficulty in walking, paralysis, paresthesia, continuous pain and pallor. And if there is paralysis and paresthesia, that suggests the limb threatening ischemia, and that patient should be treated as early as possible. Because if they take more time to get the treatment, then the patient may lose the limb, because the limb, once it loses sensory and motor movements, if there is sensory loss and there are no movements in the limb, then that limb cannot be salvaged. So here the time is very important and it should be referred as early as possible. In advanced peripheral vascular disease, may manifest as mottling in the fishnet pattern, mottling on the skin, pulselessness, numbness and cyanosis. Paralysis may follow after that and the extremity may become cold, and after that gangrene may happen. So in that case, it is urgent intervention is required and should be referred for tertiary care center. So coming to the risk of PVD, these are the risk factor: age over 50 years, smokers, diabetes, overweight patients. It is more common in males than females, and sedentary lifestyle is again a cause of PVD. So exercise is more important. People who have hypertension and high cholesterol, they are at high risk of PVD. And family history of heart and vascular diseases can again lead to PVD. There are the different grades of pain, like we grade it 1 to 4, like mild pain, moderate pain, severe pain and excruciating pain. For the, this is a pain scale for PVD. So now we came to know how to diagnose a patient of PVD when it comes to OPD. And once we diagnose, we make a diagnosis of PVD, so how to evaluate that patient, what to do next. So what we can do is we can take ankle to brachial index, that is ABI. It is most important thing to do. What we do is we take blood pressure in the arm and blood pressure in the leg, and we divide blood pressure in the arm by blood pressure in the leg. That is called ankle brachial index. If the ankle brachial index is 1 or more than 0.9, then it is normal. But if it is less, then that indicates there is some obstructive pathology in the arteries supplying the leg. And if it is less than 5, or that suggests there is a multi-level arterial disease in the lower limb, maybe at the iliac level or femoral artery or below knee. And if the ABI is less than 0.26, indicates severe limb threatening arterial compromise. And then once the ABI is abnormal, we can again go further and evaluate that person with duplex color Doppler. So with the color Doppler, we will come to know where are the blocks, how is the velocity, and it localizes the segment which is affected, whether it is a iliac artery, femoral artery or tibial artery. And once the color Doppler is done, we can do either direct intervention, or maybe to confirm the color Doppler findings, we do CT or MR angiography. It is useful mainly evaluating the arterial dissections and to get the vessel wall morphology. It also gives idea about plaque morphology and composition of the plaque, whether it is a fatty plaque, unstable plaque or stable plaque. If it is an unstable plaque and fatty plaque, that may keep on giving embolic episodes. The small emboli will form at that plaque level and go down into the small vessels, and that causes the small arterial blocks. So if that is the case, we need to treat that. It all CT or MR angiography also gives idea about exact hardware to be used for intervention, like how many stents we may require, and we can decide the budget of that patient also. Once the CT or MR is done, most of the times DSA is not required, and we can directly go for intervention like angioplasty or stenting. But if the CT is the information is not good, we can directly go for DSA. In that, we can get dynamic information, how is the blood flow going, whether how is the perfusion of that limb. So coming this, till now we discussed about the clinical diagnosis and investigation. First, we diagnose the patient, we come to a conclusion whether it is arterial disease or venous disease, and if it is arterial disease, we go for arterial or venous disease, we go for Doppler examination. First, at OPD, we can do ABI. If the ABI is normal, that rules out arterial disease. And after that, go for Doppler examination and SOS, CT or MR angiography. And once the diagnosis is done, we come to the treatment. In treatment part, main thing is we need to tell the patient that exercise is important. We can treat them medically, modify diet. If they are smokers, stop smoking. And the medical treatment wise, either patients may need interventional radiology treatment, surgery or gene based therapy. So now we will be discussing about interventional radiology treatments. It can be angioplasty, angioplasty with stent, or if it is acute thrombus, it can be thrombolytic therapy. And sometimes if there is a dissection, we need to correct that dissection flap, and there we may need stent grafts. Sometimes patients may have aneurysms in the big arteries, like aortic aneurysms, and that also can be treated by stent grafts. So coming to the example, you can see this is a patient with large thoracic aortic aneurysm. This is like a bomb sitting there. Once it ruptures, we can't save the patient. Patient dies within a minute because it is a very big. So in this case, what we do is we put a covered stent. You can see this is a covered stent from here till down. So what happens, the blood coming from the heart directly goes through the covered stent down, and this aneurysm is excluded from the circulation. So this is the treatment of choice nowadays, because surgical management of such cases is has very high risk. So, and this is, this can be done percutaneously with a small incision in the groin. Coming to the arterial venous recanalization by angioplasty and stenting, the main principle of angioplasty is what we do is we dilate the artery so that the intima breaks inside the artery, and that causes remodeling of the intima, and that causes increase in the diameter and increase in the flow. This is the principle for any angioplasty which we do. So we will discuss from aorta till down. So coming to aortoiliac occlusive disease, it typically involves the distal abdominal aorta as well as common or external iliac arteries. Aortobifemoral bypass with a prosthetic graft has been the traditional treatment of choice, but nowadays since there is a more operative morbidity and mortality, the treatment of choice is angioplasty and stent. So here you can see this patient's aorta just below the, this is a supramesenteric artery, the aorta is completely occluded and reforming down with the collaterals, and patient was having very high BP because of aortic occlusion. So what we did angioplasty. This is a guide wire going through that occlusion, this is the occluded area, and this is a balloon inflated there, and after balloon angioplasty you can see the aorta is completely opened up. If it opens completely with balloon, there is no need of putting stent, and if it is resistant to balloon, then we put stents also. Then coming to the iliac angioplasty, in this patient was having claudication, which was claudication distance was less than 200 meters. So in this case, we did angiography from the left side. You can see the right iliac artery is completely occluded. We punctured the right femoral and did the angio from both sides. You can see this is the segment of iliac artery which is occluded, and this is a collateral which is filling this artery. But this collateral circulation is not sufficient, that's why the patient is having pain. So in that case, we can cross the lesion with guide wire and put the stent there, and you can see this is a post stenting picture, the artery is opened up. So coming to the superficial femoral artery occlusion, these patients present with symptoms of claudication of the calf and sole of the foot. If the disease is in the iliac artery, it causes buttock claudication, that pain in the buttock. But if the disease is down in the thigh, that is in superficial femoral artery, it causes claudication in the calf and sole, and it usually improves as collateral circulation develops. The best treatment initially is if the antiplatelet therapy in combination with vigorous exercise program. So if the claudication is distance is more than 200 meters, there is no need of any intervention, surgical intervention or any other intervention, but only conservative treatment can help. We can tell the patient to do as much as possible exercise so that the collaterals will develop, and at that time we have to start antiplatelets so that the disease will not progress. This is a case of complete occlusion of superficial femoral artery. You can see there are so many collaterals developed there, and but this was not sufficient, and we did the angioplasty, and since only balloon angioplasty was not sufficient, we had to put stent from here till here, and after stenting you can see the flow is now improved. Coming to the tibial artery disease, if the block is below knee, the distal atherosclerotic disease involving the tibioperoneal trunk and the tibial vessels is most difficult to treat and leads to greatest morbidity and tissue loss. In these cases, ABI will be less than 0.4 and patients most of the times will have rest pain and sometimes tissue loss, that is ulcer. So this is an example of popliteal artery. You can see there is a complete occlusion of popliteal artery and there was a lesion here in the posterior tibial artery also. So we did angioplasty for both. This is a popliteal artery opened up completely after balloon angioplasty, and the tibial artery was also treated with balloon angioplasty. These patients usually present with non-healing ulcer or gangrene. Another example of tibial artery occlusion here, tibioperoneal trunk is occluded. We did balloon angioplasty and this is post balloon angioplasty. It is completely opened up. So we can treat any disease and affecting any vessels in the body, whether it is aorta, IVC or iliac arteries, femoral arteries or tibial arteries. Tibial arteries treatment is needed only if there is a tissue loss or critical limb ischemia. Otherwise, we can manage conservatively. If the patient is having continuous pain or if there is an arterial ulcer, then we need to do tibial angioplasty so that the blood flow to that ulcer or ischemic area will increase and that will help to heal that wound. And the aim of doing tibial artery angioplasty is to heal the wound and limb salvage. Once the wound is healed, even if that artery gets blocked, nothing will happen because the collateral circulation will take care. But if we don't increase the blood supply, the wound will not heal. We keep on doing dressings, but the sometimes wounds don't heal. So we need to investigate those people and do the intervention. So till now we discussed the diseases affecting lower limb. Now few slides about upper limb disease. Most common segment affected for the upper limb vessels is the subclavian artery and brachiocephalic artery. These patients usually don't have symptoms, but there will be large discrepancy in the blood pressure in the both limbs. On one side it will be very high and one side it will be very less. In that case, we come to know that there is a less blood supply on one limb, that means there is low blood supply to that region and we have to suspect the disease. So it is always better to take blood pressure in both limbs if one limb is showing very less blood pressure. So this is an example of subclavian stenting. You can see this patient was having numbness and tingling in the right upper limb. We did angiogram. The blood pressure on this limb was very less. Angiography showed there is around 90% stenosis here in the subclavian artery. And this is a balloon mounted stent placed there and it was completely opened up. And after this, the patient's symptoms were reduced. Some patients may have Burgers disease, that is thromboangitis obliterans. It is a very difficult disease to treat. It is characterized by acute inflammatory lesion and occlusive thrombosis of the arteries as well as veins. It has very strong association with cigarette smoking, commonly occurs in males between 20 to 40 years and mainly involves the arteries of the upper limbs, wrist, and usually affects the lower limbs, toes and foot. In Burgers disease, clinically, patients will have intermittent claudication in the either foot or upper limb. Pain, they will have pain during rest, pain in the toes. See, if it is atherosclerotic disease, the patients patient's pain will reduce in while they rest. But in these cases, they will have pain during rest also. The coldness due to persistent ischemia may be there. Patients will have paresthesia, like low sensation in that region. But pulsations in the posterior tibial or dorsalis pedis may be absent or weak. Extremities are red or cyanotic, and ulceration or gangrene are frequent complications of Burgers disease. But sometimes it will be reversible. This is also called thromboangitis obliterans. So treatment wise, we have to advise the person to stop smoking. We give vasodilators so that the spasm will be relieved and the flow will increase. Vasodilators are needed to prevent the progression of the disease and avoid the trauma to that limb, because if see already the limb is ischemic and if there is some trauma, it may disease may progress. Coming to the Raynaud's phenomena, it refers to intermittent episodes during which small arteries or arterioles of the left or right arm goes into spasm, causing changes in skin color and temperature. It is again a reversible disease, generally unilateral, affects one limb. It may occur after trauma or neurologic lesions or occlusive arterial disease, or most common is connective tissue disorder. Characterized by reduction of blood flow to the fingers, manifested by cutaneous vessel constriction and results in blanching, pallor of that limb. Coming to the Raynaud's disease, it is unknown etiology, may be due to immunologic abnormalities, and most of these patients should be referred to rheumatologist. If there is a Raynaud's disease, most of the times they treat it, because for such cases, we can't do angioplasty and angiostenting. So these patients should be managed by rheumatologist. Clinically, Raynaud's disease presents bilaterally. It is all because of arterial spasm. It causes sluggish blood flow, causes pallor, coldness, numbness, cutaneous cyanosis and pain. Following the spasm, the involved area becomes intensely reddened and tingling and throbbing sensations may be there. With long-standing or prolonged Raynaud's disease, patients may have ulcerations on that limb or fingers or toes. This is a typical picture of Raynaud's disease. For the Raynaud's disease, we aim to prevention of this occurrence. Person is advised to protect against exposure to cold. It is more common when the limb is exposed to cold. Quit smoking, and drug therapy wise, we give vasodilators, as I had told. Sometimes sympathectomy can help to increase the blood flow to that limb, because once we block the sympathetic nerve to that limb, we can do either percutaneous sympathectomy by injecting alcohol into that nerve. That causes vasodilation of that artery supplying the limb and reduces the symptoms. Coming to the thrombosis, till now we discussed atherosclerosis and this upper limb diseases, Raynaud's disease and connective tissue disorders. But sometimes there will be sudden formation of thrombus in the body, and that may lead to ischemia. So the treatment for that is different. Because of coagulopathy or any other disorder, patients may have sudden formation of thrombus in the arteries, and that may lead to ischemia of that limb. So in that case, we do thrombolysis, because since there is a fresh thrombus, if we put stent there, even stent also gets blocked. So in that case, we have to do thrombolysis and suck out that thrombus. This is a picture, you can, this is a case, 35-year-old male smoker. He was treated for many months and diagnosed as carpal tunnel syndrome, but actually he was having ischemic upper limb disease. He developed sudden coldness of the hand and came to hospital within 3 hours. The upper limb was cold. Patient was directly taken for angiography. You can see the radial artery from here down is completely blocked, and here also it is blocked. So we did thrombolysis. We thrombolyzed this patient with TPA for 24 hours, and this is after 24 hours, the artery was completely opened up. the circulation to the hand was completely opened up, and this is the next day picture. The hand was warm and red. So if it is a fresh thrombus, this is a, another case, brachial artery acute thrombosis. So it was again thrombolyzed, and this is post thrombolysis, it was completely opened up. So similar process can happen into vein also, that is called deep vein thrombosis. So in that case, what we do, here also we do thrombolysis, but if the thrombus load is very high, we have to do catheter directed thrombolysis. So in that case, what we do is we put the catheter inside that vein and we suck out the thrombus. This is a newer method. We have got multiple devices to suck the thrombus. I will show the picture. This patient, you can see, he was having complete thrombosis of lower limb veins. So in that case, what we do is we puncture the popliteal vein, and through the popliteal vein we go into the circulation. I think this video is not working. So you can see there is no flow into the vein. From the popliteal vein above, there is no flow. All veins are thrombosed. If the patients come in acute stage, we can treat such patients and open the veins completely. I will show the procedure, how we do it. First, what we do is we put the pigtail catheter and macerate the thrombus. We loosen the thrombus. And after that, this is a suction catheter. We take the suction catheter up and suck out all the thrombus. In this case, once we suck out all the thrombus, we came to know that there is a chronic occlusion of the iliac artery, chronic stenosis there. And if there is underlying cause, we treat that with angioplasty. I will show you directly. So we did balloon angioplasty, but this was not opening up. Finally, we have to put stent here. This stent is deployed, you can see, in the iliac vein. And this is again balloon dilatation of the stent. And you can see the vein is completely opened up. And now this is the final picture. All the femoral vein, iliac veins, everything is opened up and the flow is going into the IVC. So if the patients come within first 2 to 3 weeks, this procedure can be done, and immediately after the procedure the patients become normal within 24 to 48 hours. Because you might have seen many people having chronic DVT suffering for life. They will have pain, swelling, redness intermittently for life. So that is called post-thrombotic syndrome, and that post-thrombotic syndrome can be avoided if we do early intervention. So this can be done only in first 15 to 20 days, and if the patient comes after 20 days, what happens is this formed thrombus causes damage to the walls into the vein, and once the walls are damaged, even after we do such therapy, it will not work. Again it gets thrombosed. So important point here is we need to intervene as early as possible to get good results. This is the thrombus sucked from that limb, and this is the next step. You can see the limb edema is completely gone and patient limb was almost normal. So coming to the simple disease, phlebitis, it is inflammation of the leg veins. It can affect the superficial vein as well as deep vein. If it is superficial vein, we call superficial thrombophlebitis, or if it is deep vein, we call as DVT. It can be caused by infection or injury, and common treatment is we give antibiotic for 1 week, broad spectrum antibiotic and anti-inflammatory drugs. Coming to the pulmonary embolism, again these DVT patients, the clot may migrate up into the lungs and can cause pulmonary embolism. And in those cases, also we can do thrombolysis for the pulmonary embolism, that is called catheter-directed thrombolysis. And we put IVC filter to avoid recurrent pulmonary embolism. So coming to the next type of disease, varicose veins. As we know, varicose veins is a very common disease, and it is seen at, I think everybody might be seeing patients very commonly. The most common causes are standing job or continuous sitting job, and sometimes it may be hereditary or post-pregnancy. Most common treatment and treatment of choice nowadays is laser therapy for varicose veins. And these patients can present with either reticular veins or large veins, or large veins with skin changes and ulcer, and all such patients can be treated by endovenous laser therapy. I'll just show the video how we do it. So this is a typical procedure kit we get, and this is a laser machine. This is a needle guide wire. So what we do is, this is a sheath. We puncture the vein, the affected vein. I will go under ultrasound guidance. Yeah. So this is an incompetent perforator. What we do, we puncture that perforator directly with a 18 gauge needle. You can see this is the needle going into the perforator. Once the needle is inside the perforator, we put the laser fiber. This is a laser fiber inside that perforator. And once we reach the target, we just burn that for 5 seconds. You can see this is a laser fiber going into the perforator. And once we, yeah, this is, I am giving laser energy. You can see air bubble formation in that. Once we give laser energy, the intima of the laser, this is a laser fiber tip, intima gets destroyed and the perforator gets destroyed. This is for perforator. And when the great saphenous vein and short saphenous veins are dilated, see, you can see, we see the patient under color Doppler. You can see this is a great saphenous vein. What we do is, we puncture the great saphenous vein with the small needle, as I had showed earlier. Once the blood flow is spontaneously coming out, we put a small guide wire inside that vein. You can see, we punctured with a small needle. This is a guide wire, and over the guide wire we put a small sheath. This is a 4-French sheath. So once the guide wire is put, sheath is put, we put local anesthetic agent along the vein, so that the laser, once we deliver laser energy, that should not affect the surrounding structures along the vein. You can see, this is my small spinal 24 gauge spinal needle. I am giving this is called perivenous tumescent anesthesia. You can see it is raising that fascia. So once that is done, we just give the laser energy and pull back the system. And yeah, once the laser is given, while giving laser energy, we pull back this assembly, and that's all. Once that is done, with a small pinhole, all the veins, varicose veins, will be ablated. You can see here I am giving laser energy and pulling back that system. And immediately after the surgery, we put on the stockings on that leg, and immediately after the surgery, the patient starts walking outside the OT. So it is very simple. There is no cutting, no stitches, and results wise it is best, and it gives almost 94%, it has 94% success rate compared to surgery, which has got around 60% success rate. Cost wise, this kit is little costly. It cost only kit cost around 40,000, and that's why the cost is more, maybe around 60-70,000 we can do. See, once we ablate the vein, it will not open because the success rate is very high, around 94-95%. But patient should modify their lifestyle. Even after doing surgery, if the patient is having standing job and he continues to doing that, the other vein which are normal now will become varicose. So to avoid that, we need to modify lifestyle. So once the vein which is ablated, it will not open, but the other veins may open, and that is not in our hand. The veins which are normal now, we can't ablate. And the, see, in leg there will be more than 200 veins. So main truncal veins are great saphenous vein and short saphenous vein. But once we ablate that, the other veins will take over. And to avoid further recurrence, we have to modify the lifestyle and avoid long standing, long sitting. So these are the examples. You can see this is the patient with the varicose veins, and this is after treatment, the veins were completely gone. The another patient, large varicosities completely disappeared after laser therapy. This patient was having non-healing ulcer since 6 months. It was not healing with any treatment. So he was having underlying varicose veins as a cause. We treated that with the laser, and this is after 1 month, the wound was completely healed. The another patient, pre-laser, there is a large wound here, and within 1 week it started healing. Again, varicose ulcer, non-healing varicose ulcer, completely healed after laser therapy. Actually, this patient should be referred to us before they develop the ulcer, but most of the times the patients come at the later, last stage. So these are the pictures available with me. So to conclude, there are many advantages of interventional radiology. Most of the interventions can be done on daycare basis or OPD basis. There is no cutting, no stitches. The recovery time needed is very less, and very less morbidity and mortality. The access we take for treatment is very small, less than 2 millimeter in diameter. And there is no dissection. Immediate ambulation is possible. Minimal hospital stay is needed, and that leads to better quality of life. Coming to the disadvantages, some people feel it is costly, but if we consider the morbidity and patient discomfort which is caused by other therapies, it is very superior. By doing, for example, for doing laser, we can discharge the patient same day. But if we do open surgery, patient has to remain admitted for around 4 to 5 days minimum. And again, there will be stitches, cutting, risk of infection, all that will be there. So considering that, I think cost is should not, considering the hospital stay and time lost, the cost is not high for laser therapy or any other interventions. When we take a proper care, the radiation is not at all a problem, and there is no radiation risk. And now we are available for all possible interventions, so you can refer all your patients to us. Thank you. You can ask any doubts. Yeah. 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 You have to keep on doing calf exercises. Like we can keep on moving your legs so that the calf pump will work and the blood will return towards lung. Other thing is, if you are very worried about DVT, you can take injection of clexane just before boarding your flight or long flight or anywhere, and that should be fine. It acts for 12 hours. Some people advise taking oral anticoagulants. Nowadays we have Navox available. It comes by name Xarelto. The Xarelto 10 milligram tablet we can take. It starts action within half an hour and the action remains for 12 hours. That is medical treatment, but otherwise doing calf exercises helps a lot. Actually, stent cost lam asel kiwa chota asel tar same as asti. Pan there is a limit for length of the stent. Je lesions are 20 centimeter asel, tar 20 centimeter stent yet nahi. Ma aplyala 10 10 che don takayla lagta. Mag te cost double hote. Asa hota. Stent lam asel tar mhanje kimmat vadat nahi, pan te number of stents vadtat. Tyachyamule kimmat vadte. Stent dislodgement. No, they don't dislodge because we take appropriate size of the stent for that artery. So it gets stuck to the wall.
It will not.
Yeah, it is important. We can give peripheral vasodilators. But if the distance is less than 200 meters, the disease will be more. So we need to evaluate those patients with color Doppler and then SOS CT angiography. And once we see the CT picture, we come to know whether this patient needs intervention or not. So if the distance is less than 200 meters, it needs intervention. That is the rule. If the distance is more than 200 meter, there is no need of treatment. We can give, that is a vitamin only, so that's not a problem. Yeah, brandy and this thing causes vasodilatation. So we can. No, it causes vasodilatation in the arteries.
Yeah.
No, not veins. Alcohol means that is absolute alcohol. Absolute means 100% alcohol. So that causes necrosis of that area, nerve. So once we block the nerve, the sensations will not be carried to that, like that vasoconstriction sensations. So sympathetic action will be lost and then vessels dilate, vasodilatation happens. Earlier days, we used to open and cut the nerves, but now we can just inject the alcohol, it causes the damage.
Sir, any problem?
See, it cannot be given in patients who has deranged this renal function. It is not studied, renal function. If the creatinine is high, we can't give. Yeah. Other thing is, it is not studied in children's, and again it should not be given in elderly people more than 65-70. Yeah. For 1 month it cost around 3,000. Yeah. Initially we give BD for therapeutic reasons. If you want to give therapeutic dose, it is 15 mg BD for 21 days. and then 20 mg OD for 6 months. But for this thing, if you are taking for only short distance travel and all, you can take only 10 mg, that is prophylactic dose. Chalo, thank you. Atano Panas Panas Sejais Sunek
Bartas
Rubilas, actually. Sadrila Todanas Kadikadi means attached Sagikadis.